Hi, everyone. My name is Jenna McNeill, and I'm a pulmonary critical care attending at Massachusetts General Hospital. Today, we will be discussing how to diagnose pulmonary hypertension. Key takeaways for today are to understand the clinical tools that raise suspicion for pulmonary hypertension and the role of right heart catheterization. So when we think about pulmonary hypertension, we should think about some of the symptoms that someone may present with. So for example, someone with pulmonary hypertension may come in with shortness of breath, chest pressure or tightness, increased fatigue or lower extremity swelling, and in more severe cases, they could present with syncope. In addition to symptoms for pulmonary hypertension, there are other diagnostic tools that can be helpful in diagnosing pulmonary hypertension. For example, on physical exam, there could be evidence of an S4 indicating high right ventricular pressure or hypertrophy, or an increased S2, which would be suggestive of high pulmonary pressures forcing close the pulmonic valve. Along with cardiac findings, you may also see that patients have lower extremity swelling. On EKG, you may see right atrial enlargement, evidence of right ventricular hypertrophy, a right axis deviation, or a right bundle branch block. On chest X-ray, you may see prominent central pulmonary artery, RV enlargement, or peripheral hypovascularity, which is suggestive of vascular pruning, which is a potential finding that you see in patients with underlying pulmonary hypertension. When we think about pulmonary hypertension, another diagnostic tool that is very helpful for us is an echocardiogram. When we think about TTE, things that could suggest pulmonary hypertension are right atrial enlargement, which you will see on the bottom right of the screen, as well as RV enlargement. Other etiologies include flattening of the septum, which you will see in the upper right part of your screen, where the left ventricle is flattened by a right ventricle that is enlarged. In addition, the measurement of the peak tricuspid regurgitation velocity, as measured by Doppler across the tricuspid valve, is very helpful in suggesting pulmonary hypertension. As we just discussed, the tricuspid regurgitation velocity is a critical tool to help us categorize the concern for pulmonary hypertension. So for example, if the tricuspid regurgitation jet is greater than 2.8, with additional features on TTE, such as evidence of RV enlargement or right atrial enlargement, the risk of pulmonary hypertension is intermediate. And as the TR jet increases from 2.8 to greater than 3.4, the risk for pulmonary hypertension enters into a high-risk category. When we think about tricuspid regurgitation velocity, not only is it helpful in thinking about the likelihood of pulmonary hypertension, but this value is also used to calculate the right ventricular systolic pressure by the formula you will see at the top of the screen, where we take the velocity, we square it, and then we multiply it by 4. When this number is greater than 40, this is again suggestive of pulmonary hypertension. Unfortunately, an echocardiogram or a TTE is not a perfect test for pulmonary hypertension. It can be inaccurate in close to 50% of patients. As seen in the figure, the solid line represents pulmonary artery pressures as measured by right heart catheterization, and the dots represent the difference between the TTE or echocardiogram measurements and the pulmonary artery pressures, with the dotted lines as a 95% confidence interval. A TTE should be used as a tool to identify those at risk for pulmonary hypertension. But as we will discuss, when we want to make the final diagnosis, a right heart catheterization is going to be vital to give us a true understanding of whether or not a patient has pulmonary hypertension. When we're thinking about diagnosing pulmonary hypertension, there's one group in particular that is going to require further diagnostics. And this is group 4, which is called chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension. If a patient has suggestion of pulmonary hypertension on TTE without evidence of lung disease and has risk factors for chronic thrombolic pulmonary hypertension. For example, prior pulmonary embolism, a history of splenectomy, antiphospholipid syndrome or some hypercoagulable state, or chronic inflammation, there are additional workup tools that need to be performed, such as a ventilation perfusion scan for evidence of perfusion defects. And if the perfusion scan is positive, these patients would need to be referred to a tertiary center for a pulmonary angiogram. As we mentioned, an echocardiogram is very helpful for potential suggestion of pulmonary hypertension, but a right heart catheterization is the way we confirm the diagnosis. And not only does it help confirm the diagnosis, it can help us classify the type of pulmonary hypertension and help guide therapy. When we perform a right heart catheterization, this is typically done through venous access, either through the internal jugular vein, brachial access, or femoral access. The position of the Swan scan catheter is confirmed via wave tracings, as you'll see on the screen here, as well as by fluoroscopy imaging. When we think about the position of the right heart catheterization, we initially go in and we measure the right atrial pressure, which is typically between 0 and 5 millimeters of mercury. This pressure then increases when we move from the right atrium to the right ventricle, with increased systolic pressures in the 20s to 30s and diastolics from the 0 to 5 range in normal physiology. You can determine that you have moved from the right ventricle into the pulmonary artery when you notice that there is a step up in the diastolic pressure, as well as evidence of a dicrotic notch, which is indicating that the pulmonic valve has closed. Finally, when you move from the pulmonary artery pressure to the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, again, under normal physiology, you will see a drop in the pressure with a normal wedge pressure, typically in the range of 8 to 12. By performing a right heart catheterization, we are then able to classify the type of pulmonary hypertension based upon the hemodynamic values that we accrue. So for example, pre-capillary pulmonary hypertension would be defined as a mean pulmonary artery pressure greater than 20, along with a pulmonary capillary wedge pressure equal to or less than 15, and a pulmonary vascular resistance greater than 3. This would then be different from post-capillary pulmonary hypertension, which again, you would see an elevated mean pulmonary artery pressure greater than 20. However, in this situation, you have an elevation in the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure greater than 15. Again, this value is a surrogate for the left-sided pressures within the heart. And you would have a pulmonary vascular resistance less than 3. If there is combined etiology, that would be then seen or defined as pre and post capillary pulmonary hypertension, and you would get a mixture within the hemodynamics. So again, you would see a mean pulmonary artery pressure greater than 20. However, in this situation, you would both have an elevation in the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure, as well as an increase or an elevation in the pulmonary vascular resistance greater than 3. Thank you for watching. I hope you found this topic helpful.